Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to this last series of talks for this World Summit. And right now, we're going to listen to Ekkehard Gentz, and he will tell us everything about how he made the awesome Qt World Summit app that you're all using. Ekkehard?
So, welcome to this session, and I hope you all have installed the Qt World Summit conference app. It's running on Android and iOS and also on Windows 10. And now I want to tell you something about the story behind this application and why I did this and about my experiences. So if you look at the difference between these two pictures, you see that I already survived many technologies. I started long time ago with assembler and COBOL and Fortran Basic and also followed by Java. And then I came to mobile app development and started with Java ME for BlackBerry OS. And this also followed by BlackBerry 10 Cascades, which relies on Qt 4.8, but has a totally different UI control set. And so as you all know, probably BlackBerry hasn't so much success with BlackBerry 10, so in the meantime, they also have Android devices. And so my customers, I'm working as an independent software architect, are asking for cross-platform applications running on BlackBerry 10 and Android and iOS and probably Windows 10. And this was the reason why I started with Qt. My goal to write mobile business applications is always they must be easy to use, performant, and follow the UI style guides. And from my experiences with BlackBerry 10 Cascades, this was a really great user experience. And I also looked some time ago at Qt Quick 1, and I've seen no, there is nothing already available for real mobile applications. But this has changed with the Qt Quick controls too. And of course, I have also compared with other frameworks. You know, at the market, these like things like Apache Cordova, Ionic, Angular, React Native, Xamarin, or Qt. And always when I compare the source codes of these other frameworks with a Qt QML application, I must say I always love this way how Qt applications are built. It's much easier than have a mix of HTML and JavaScript and native code and so on. And so I decided to give Qt Quick Controls 2 a chance. And as you probably know, you can have UI controls for Google Material or Windows Universal or a default style with Qt Quick Controls. There's no styling for iOS yet, but hopefully in the near or not so near future, there will also be a styling for iOS. It's important to know all the rules and the guidelines from Google for Google Material, because all of this is built into the Quick controls. And so you should really take a look at the Google Material style guide, where you find exactly the descriptions, how buttons should look, how labels and the fonts and sizes and opacity and so on. And there are many, many small details to follow. And the team from Qt with JP Nomi and Mitch Curtis and so did a really great job to implement not all yet, but the most needed controls for Google Material. At first, we have some UI controls working as a container. You always need some containers where you put other controls in, and the container controls here from Qt Quick Controls 2 are at the root element is the application window. Then you have a plain container where you can put things in. There's a frame, group box, then a page. A page is a pane with the knowledge that it's living in a material application, knows about the background, about the fonts, and all this styling, and also can have headers and footers. A pane is only a simple pane which you can define always, and also this pane knows about the Google Material. Then we have a stack view, swipe view, tab bar, and toolbar. These are container controls, but also navigation controls. This is the most important for a mobile application. You need controls to navigate through the application. And this wasn't possible without huge work to create this all by yourself before Qt Controls 2 are available. And so these navigation controls are all you need for a Google Material application. There's the drawer. You know, you can swipe from the side. There's a stack view where you can push pages on top and with pop remove from the stack. There's a swipe view where you can swipe between pages. There's a tab bar where you tip on the tabs, or tab buttons living inside a tab bar. If you take a look at the conference application, you will find all of this in the application. You have the drawer where all the different destinations are defined. We have a stack view. You have a tip on a session in a list, and then a page will be pushed on top of this stack view, and then you can again get the details and the speakers and the room, and this all is a stack. Always uses a stack view. The swipe view is used for the two conference days. You can swipe or you can use the tab bar on the top to switch between the two conference days. And there's a really good documentation where all these navigation controls are described, how they work, what they do, and you can go into the details. I really recommend that you take a look at the documentation. So, if you start with Qt Quick Controls 2, the best is to see an example what is provided out of the box from the Qt Quick Controls. And there's a sample application named Gallery. It's important if you have your creator opened and only search for Gallery. There are some galleries. You have to search for Gallery Qt Quick Controls 2. This is always with some of the UI controls. They also live in other areas of Qt, like Qt Quick or widgets, and so you have best is always if you do a Google search to add controls to get the right one. So. So this is the gallery application you get as an example what you can do with the Qt Quick Controls. I'm starting it here as a desktop application on OS X because this is easier as to connect my phones here. You all have the application on your phone, so you can believe me that it runs on Android and iOS. But the easiest way to test the application is to run it as a desktop application. At first, as I started, I always did it on my device, and then because I only wanted to test mobile application, I said I don't need a desktop application. And then JP Nomis told me, use this desktop application for really fast testing and resizing the app and so on, and then do it on the devices. Because doing mobile applications, this is always good or required from my point of view that you test it not on simulators, you need real devices. So, and here is the gallery where you have a drawer. This drawer here is a simple list view, and there is nothing more there. There are no dividers, no subtitles, no icons, and a typical material style application needs this. And you can see in the conference app that I have all of this included there. But it's not out of the box. But it's easy to customize. I will show you. So you can from here see all these different things. You can try out a stack view. You see here buttons not really looking like Google Material style buttons, but they are also part of Google Material. So you have flat buttons, you have raised buttons, you have different kind of styles there. So, but it's a really easy way to learn how it works. Take a look at this gallery application because you find some lines of source code for each UI control available for the quick controls. A real application like the conference application looks something more complex. And I have tried to have to make a illustration here to show you how the application works from the application design. At the left, you have the drawer, and the drawer has buttons, and each button points to a destination of the application. For the conference apps, this is the schedule, speakers, venue, settings, and so on. Each application destination can be of a different type. This can be here, this button 3, where you have only a simple page. A simple page is the about application. They have only a page, there is nothing on top, and you go back then. So maybe you have only a page. Or it can be the swipe view, and the swipe view is for the schedule for the days. A swipe view itself contains some pages or some stack views. It can be of different types. We have a stack view. If you open the speaker list, this is a list view as a base, as a root list for the stack view. And then if you tap on a row of the list and open the speaker detail page, then it will be put on top of the stack. This is a stack view. And important to know, the root element of the application itself is a stack view. So the drawer where you always select one entry is a stack view, but this stack view only has one item. And this item will be switched. So I cannot only push something on a stack view, I can also say switch the page. And all my pages I'm using are created using loaders. And so if you tip on a selection on the from the drawer, the content of this initial root item of the stack view will be changed. And so this is important to know. You always have a stack view at the root. And in my application to find the way, I have at first the application window. This is the total screen available, the space available on a screen from the smartphone or tablet. And inside this application window, I have this root stack view. And then on top, different destinations. And to find functions or properties, I'm always using a strict naming scheme in my application. I have an app window, is the root, then comes the root pane, this is this single stack view, this is one entry, and then the next is always named nav pane as a navigation pane, this, which could be a stack view, a swipe view, and so on. So I have always, without the need of using extra signals and slots or so, I know the way to the root, because at the application window, I have many properties, we'll show it to you, where I can have access to different values I need for labels of different sizes, and or if you change the style from the light to the dark style, or change the colors from material. The last 8 months, while I learned the Qt Quick controls, I started and tried to implement real applications using a stack view, a swipe view, different label sizes, and so on. And all these single applications are at GitHub as open source projects, so you can follow my path I went the last months. And the first what I did was to implement a stack view. So here's a simple application with a stack view where I'm using buttons to push pages on top and to pop pages and go on, jump to another page. You can, if you have a fixed stack of pages, you can also jump to from page 2 to page 7 and tell the stack view not to instantiate all the pages between. So if you have a stack and you cache this and come back later and want to point the user to the same location as before, you don't have to instantiate all the pages below. And these pages will only instantiated if you go directly to these pages. Perhaps if you make a pop from the page 7, then the page 6 becomes active, and if it's not instantiated, then the stack view does it for you. The stack view automatically loads and destroys the applications if you want so, and this is very comfortable. And here you can see I have also done different types of buttons. Here we have a flat design button, and if we go back, here were raised buttons with different colors, colored with the primary color or with the accent color. Google Material has two colors important, the primary color and the accent color. And depending from these colors, the Qt-Quick controls automatically know the correct color of the text on top of this. So this was then I did the same for swipe view. Swipe view is not so easy to implement because you not only have the different pages where you can swipe through, but you also have on top a tab bar normally. Google says normally that you have a tab bar complemented with a swipe view, so you can swipe or tip on the tab. And also, if you have more pages, as for this conference app, where I have only two conference days, you have these indicators below the page. So the user knows where he currently is. This is good for wizards, where you go through some pages, formulas to questions to answer, or so on, or fill out an order, what is all possible. The swipe view has no comfort of automatically creating and destroying the objects. It is up to you. And also you have to using the current index, you are required to also set the corresponding index of the tab bar or of the page indicator. So on here you can see there are the page indicators, and this changes, and also I have the back button here on top. This is a really simple swipe view. Same as with tab bars, you can create different kind of tab bars on the top, on the bottom, with icons, with text, or icons and text. You can place it outside of the toolbar and take a look at the sample application where I have provided this. Here's the current index must be in sync, so you connect them, say if on current index changed here, then change this other one too. And to avoid high memory consumption, In my sample app, I have implemented that in a swipe view, only the current view and the left and the right page are created. All the other ones will be unloaded, and if the page is changed, they will be activated. So I have always both pages, if I start the swiping, already instantiated, but if they run out, I'm destroying them. It's up to you. Perhaps there are other situations where you always want to have all pages created. So bottom navigation. So the bottom navigation is something coming new to Google Material Style. So here is the bottom navigation as part of the Google Material Style. For the first versions of Google Material, there was no bottom navigation, but users are requesting this. And the good thing is this looks similar to the navigation iOS users are known in their application. And that's the reason why I, in the conference application, have a combination. We have the full access to the application through the drawer, and the most important things like schedule and speakers also at the bottom in this bottom navigation bar. And so for an iPhone user, it is great. He knows this kind of navigation. And for Google Material, if you have a smartphone with a large screen, it is always difficult. Sometimes you need both hands or have to move your finger to reach the drawer. And so I think it's much easier with one thumb to navigate through the application using this bottom navigation. And there's sometimes differences between iOS and Android, and this is not a real native iOS version, but for my users this is okay. This hamburger menu is used for the drawer, is already known in iOS applications, and with the button navigation it is working. And if you replace all the icons by iOS looking icons, then it would look much better, but it is much work. I will tell you where the icons are coming from. But this is a new component for Google Material. So you are still following the Google Material Style Guide if you are using bottom navigation. Next thing, together with the Qt Quick Controls 2, and the most important thing is the high DPI support. You know this, all your phones have different density, different sizes of screens, different densities, and before it was not so easy to create pages with Qt, which look the same on all kind of devices. But this comes not automatically. In your main CPP, you have to enable the high DPI scaling. And also, there you can enable the Google Material Style. If you like the Windows Universal Style, you can also use the Universal Style here, and hopefully later an iOS Style. So these two lines you need at the start of the application. You can also put this material definition in a configuration file. There are some ways to provide this to the application, but you cannot dynamically switch between material and universal while the application is running. You have to restart the application. So next important things are the colors. As you already told, we have a primary color and an accent color. And we have different fonts. This is how Google categorized the different sizes of text. This is a body text, a caption text, a headline, display, and for each category here, there's an exact description of the opacity, of the size of the font, and so. And what you get out of the box from the Qt Quick Controls is a normal body, is a text as a body text. And from BlackBerry Cascades before, if I had a text looking something lighter gray or so, I used a color. This is not the way Google Material works. Google Material uses a black or white color, depends from the theme, and then uses opacity to get this gray here, like for the D4 or so. And all of this is described in detail here by Google. Also, there is a palette of 15 predefined colors. The same colors with the same name here, red and pink and purple, and so you will find in the application, you can say my color is material.red. Then you get this color and in the shade 500. This is the default shade. You should be aware of this because if you want to use other colors, then you have much work. You see here from the different colors, sometimes text on the colors is white, sometimes the text is black. Using these default colors, then the Quick Controls know about this. If you're using your own color, then you have to think about what this means for your application. So, these are the colors. And something same is for the fonts. Where all of this is described here, and you see you have a font for buttons. This is a medium, 14 pixels, or a subheading. This is 16 pixels, and so on. This is much work to implement all of this, but you are in luck. I have done all of this for you. In my application, you will find label title, label headline, label display 1, display 2, and so on. And you can use it, and it has the right font size, and it has the right color and opacity. Also, something not available with the first version of the Qt Controls 2, the upcoming Qt Controls 2.1 in Qt 5.8 will have a round button. This, at the moment, for Qt 5.7, there is no round button. And you know from all the material style applications that you need a floating action button. This is the main action with the preferred action you have to provide. And there's also a mini floating action button in the guidelines. And so I defined these buttons and show it to you. And as I told you, these applications are all open source. And here I have done all this work, defined not only the accent and primary color. I always also use one color. You have seen the different shades of one color. And material out of the box only gives you the default with shade 500. And I defined in my application palettes to also use a something lighter and a something darker value. So probably if you have area with a primary color and then you have a floating action button in a primary color and want to position it on top, this won't work. It depends from your color that you then use something lighter or something darker color. And also this is predefined. You can use this, and also you see these are labels done with Qt Quick Controls, and they look the same as the Google Style Guide I just demonstrated you. Here are all the different things, and also icons, buttons, and also the floating action button. Okay, you can customize all the Qt Quick Controls very easy. You have seen here I have raised buttons, I have flat buttons, I have round buttons, and in the conference application you see I have different round buttons. There is this favorites button, or I have another round button where only one character is shown, like the S for a session or key for a keynote. And all these customized controls are available from my application. You can use it and put it in your own application. Makes it easy. Next thing missing was a calendar control for current Qt Quick Controls. And I created a date picker and a time picker, looking like a Google material picker. And in the conference application, you can use the time picker. If you on the top right, there's a button where you can select jump to next to the session starting at 5 p.m. or so. This was some work, but looks nice now. And so I can wait until the original calendar controls will be available from Qt Quick. Next, in every application, you need icons. And coming back to this high DPI support, we need icons in different densities. And if you have done some Google Android app development or Apple development, you know you need your icons in so many sizes for Android or so many for iOS, and the same is for Windows 10. The good thing is Google provides download of all these icons here, and if you download these icons, you will see there are black icons and white icons in different sizes, but they are named different from the naming scheme of Qt Quick Controls. It's much work, and so always my newest open source application contains all the icons I already have converted. This is the reason why the conference application have much more icons in there as needed. So, speaker images. I'm getting speaker images from a website, and these images are of different sizes and also different DPI. I need them as with 72 DPI, and I need the sizes for scaling factor 2, 3, or 4. And you can take a look at the source code. If I'm getting the images from the server, I'm checking the DPI changes there, and then I'm scaling the images for the different sizes I need and store these images for the speakers. Ja, gucken wir gleich. Of course. Data binding. In this conference application, I decided to use an in-memory data model. All my entities like sessions and speakers and tracks and rooms and so on are QObject entities. And you know, it is always much work to describe all the properties and the QML list properties. There must be much implemented and so. And to make this easier, I'm using a generator. This generator is based on Eclipse Xtext and Xtend. And I already did this work for me for my BlackBerry 10 Cascades applications. And now I'm just reworking this generator with a friend to make this available so you can generate code for BlackBerry 10 applications or Qt applications. And all the sources you will find under gen are generated. And my model looks like this. I only define this text model with Xtext in a special editor and hit save, and all my entities will be generated. And I hope that this will be open source at the end of the year. At the moment, I'm every day changing things there to make it better. So that's okay. So if you take a look at the application here, there's a folder gen, and there all these classes are generated. And the data model itself is inside the project. You can take a look at this. We haven't enough time. And so it's really easy to use such a data model. For the caching, I'm using JSON files for this. And it is not so easy to verify if all your JSONs you are saving and so are OK. And you cannot look so easy inside the iOS app sandbox or inside the Android sandbox. So it's a good idea also to use a desktop version of the application. And then for OS X, you go to application support. And there you will find the JSON files generated by the application. Also, the lifecycle, you know that an Android application can be killed by the system. So every time the application will be suspended, I'm saving the changes. And the changes in this application are really easy. We have only favorites to set. And to avoid always to write back the complete session file, I have separated the favorites in an extra file. And then at startup of the applications, I merge this into my sessions. The loops through these some hundred sessions is really fast. So later I have not always a reference to another file. And if going in the background, being suspended or so, I'm only saving this small JSON file. This is really working fast. So all the network access works as you know it from other Qt applications. The only thing you should know, there's a bug. And this bug is on iOS only. If you have access through your network, and then you switch off the Wi-Fi, and later you switch on the Wi-Fi, it won't work. Qt doesn't get the information that the Wi-Fi is on. And the workaround is every time to instantiate the Qt Network Access Manager, what you normally would not do because it's a heavy object. But this is the only workaround at the moment to do this. Okay, internationalization, I have built something in build and deploy. You can edit the Android manifest directly from the application, and you also there is the info.plist from iOS. Take a look at this, what I have entered there. There were some issues with Xcode 8 and iOS 10 and Qt 5.7. Search in the forums, there are the solutions. Okay. Then to testing the app, I have tested the app with some developers before. It's good to do this with Google Android beta test on Apple's iTunes Connect test flight. Then you have control about this, and it's easy to do. So we are coming to the end. I have not much time. You can read about speeding up the applications in my last blog entry for Qt, how to do an async start up with a timer and be dynamic and using loaders. And I have activation policies that pages only active when selected or while selected or immediately at application startup. All is in the application. Heavy use of loaders. For BlackBerry 10, I can reuse my code. And for me, it's really easy to use the Qt Quick controls and plus an entity code generator. And of course, there are some problems and issues. Sometimes the layout orientation change doesn't work well, but we are working on this. And if, as I started new to Qt, sometimes it is really difficult to find the right documentation and to decide between what is for Qt Quick and widgets and Quick controls too, and the layouting with all the different widths and preferred widths and layout widths and minimum and so on. It is something to learn to start. Yes, some things missed. Some material effects will come in the next version of the controls. And what I'm missing for mobile application is something like a marketplace where developers can place their solutions, because everyone does the same sharing with other applications and access to contacts or calendars and so on. Would be great if there comes something. So, but overall, I got much help from forum and lists, and so I'm giving something back to the community with this application and my blog on Qt for mobile X platform application development. My slides will be available later, and all my examples available at GitHub. And for my point of view, go with the Qt quick controls. They are great UI controls, easy for X platform, runs on Android, smartphones, tablets, also on Amazon Fire OS tablets without any change, iPhones, iPads, Windows 10 Lumia. And remember, I started some time ago without any knowledge about Qt. And now you can see this application. And this is pure Qt, no native code, all Qt quick controls, and only the tip of the iceberg, what can be done to create good-looking applications running performant and from one code base. And so I'm coming to the end. There's another session about the Qt quick controls too at 4 in Tokyo. And now we have less time for questions. Yes? Hello.
So you mentioned about swipe view. So did you face the problem of page flickering?
Swipe view?
Yes.
Yes, I have demonstrated
the
swipe.
So did you face the problem of page flickering?
No.
No?
No.
Okay. So how did you know that?
Do you have flickering with the conference app?
No.
No.
But when I faced the problem of page flickering. So exactly how did you come to know that the proper number of frames were actually passed? Like,
make your code public, write in the forums or in the lists and or in my blog commands, then I will take a look at it because I have no flickering on or no device.
It's really difficult to see from like naked eye. So how did you verify that? That was my question. How did you verify that the proper number of frames were passed?
How did I verify?
So how did you verify that the proper number of frames were passed in the frame buffer? Because you were using Qt, right?
Yes.
So how did you know? Because it's on the Android platform, and Android has a different frame buffer. So how did you verify it? Like,
I do nothing. I'm only using these controls. I'm not going deep into any frame buffers or so.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, one last question.
Hi, thank you for sharing this. I was wondering if you got a chance to look at previous year apps and if you used it as a reference.
What kind of apps?
I mean the app from last year, if you got a chance to look at it.
I have not taken a look at the app from the last year.
Okay.
I created this application from scratch.
Okay.
And you always can reach me via Twitter, Ecke's Corner, or in the forum, in the list, and I will help you in my spare time.
Okay, someone has one very quick question. We have about 1 minute left.
It came to implementing some of the color styling and stuff like that. Do you just basically use OpenGL ES to shade, like, say, the icons or stuff of different colors? And is that kind of the implementation, like little shader fragments and stuff?
I don't use anything of OpenGL or so. I'm only using these Qt quick controls.
Okay, so it's all in the API calls, basically.
Yes, and I have to say, I started with Qt and doing only mobile applications, only with the Qt quick controls, and I'm not so experienced Qt developers as some of you are, and I'm not going into technical deep parts of the implementation of these controls. I'm only using them in the context of a business application.
Right, yeah, it'd be interesting to see the performance difference between the two, but actually the approach you're taking may actually be more efficient because oftentimes, you know, native calls are hopefully optimized to be the most efficient.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.